Hi everyone, welcome to the first episode of the series Mastering Post-Process Shaders in Unreal Engine. This series is inspired from my very own Art of Shader packs, which you can find on the Unreal Marketplace. For those interested, the link to my Marketplace page is in the description below. In this episode, we will understand how the post-process blendable materials work, and I will be guiding you through the process with some practical, easy-to-follow examples. Throughout the series, we will explore not just the basics of post-process material, but also dive into creating some advanced filter and distortion effect. So let's get started and unlock the full potential of post-processing shaders in Unreal Engine. So you are looking into the starter map from the starter content pack. I have chosen this map because it is much more convenient to demonstrate a post-process effect when a lot of assets are placed on a scene. Firstly, I will add a post-process volume actor and set its infinite extent to unbound, which will make the post-processing effect visible even outside the bounding volume of the actor. You will find numerous options to customize and tweak basic post-processing settings. However, our focus won't be on these general settings. Instead, what we need is this post-process materials option, which has this array. Each element within this array represents a blendable material. The essence of this array is to allow multiple different types of blendable materials to layer upon each other, resulting in a combined unique effect that suits your specific requirements. Now let's create a new material. The material domain is going to be post-process, and we are now left with just the emissive color output, which is all we are going to need. To demonstrate how this works, I will quickly create a color node and connect to it. To see its effect in the viewport, I will add this material to our blendables array. You see the entire scene is now turned to green. But usually what we would do is get the main scene first and apply some sort of modifications on top of this. For that, we will need a scene texture node. This node samples specific information from the rendered scene like color, depth, normals, etc. We will demonstrate all its capabilities in one of the later videos, but for now we will need the post-process input option, which gives you the final rendered scene as it is and only works with the post-process materials. Okay, so I will connect the color output of this node to the emissive color. Now you see the original scene unmodified. Next, we are going to add a multiply node and multiply with this color constant. We are getting this error because the scene texture is a float 4 and the color node is float 3. So I will add a mask and set it to RGB. Now you see the original scene with the green tint. If I add a desaturation node here, I can easily make this scene grayscale. Pretty neat, isn't it? If this concept is entirely new to you, I bet your mind is already buzzing with creative ideas regarding what you can do with this. And for those already familiar with the basics, stay tuned. Things are about to get more and more interesting from here onwards. To make something meaningful out of this, you will need to know the mathematical formula behind an effect that you are looking for. Consider the camera app on your smartphone or various image and video processing software like Photoshop, After Effects, or even Filmora, which I am using to edit this video. These platforms offer a variety of filters that can be applied to your images or videos. Each filter is fundamentally powered by mathematical calculations designed to manipulate aspects such as the RGB channels of your original picture or the UV coordinates for distortion effects. To give you an example, I will choose a very common and popular shader, Sepia. Sepia is a classic effect that gives images a warm brownish tone. This effect is achieved by altering the RGB channels of the image. To understand how exactly this is going to work, I will be heading over to the GPT interface and ask it to write the formula for the Sepia filter. GPT has provided me the formula in terms of RGB values,
and I'm now going to replicate this in Unreal. So I will need three color nodes, set them with the appropriate values as shown in the formula. I will then need to apply dot product to each of the RGB channels respectively. And then append the results to get the final output. Now I'm going to parameterize the color nodes so that I can further customize this filter. So you can see with the blendable materials, not just you are getting your desired outcome, but with the parameters, you can make your materials highly customizable and flexible. Next, we are going to create something a little advanced. I will ask GPT to write the formula for the mosaic filter for me. A mosaic filter is a type of effect that transforms a regular frame into a mosaic of colored tiles. Notice that instead of RGB, the texture coordinates has been manipulated. That makes this effect not a color filter, but rather a distortion effect. So let's create a new material where we are going to replicate the formula. Okay, so I'm done with the modification. Let's see how this looks in our scene. Perfect. You can see the mosaic tiles distorting our main scene. We can also modify the size of the grid by tweaking the block size parameter. So next, I'm going to ask GPT to create some sort of dispersion effect on top of this to make this filter a little bit interesting. Okay, so this time GPT is using an external texture map to manipulate the UV coordinates. I also want the dispersion to be time-based, like a sinusoidal wave-like pattern. So I asked GPT to modify the current formula. Okay, so now that we have the final formula with us, I can get back to the material editor and update the current mosaic filter with this dispersion formula. The current mosaic effect is being further distorted in a sinusoidal wave-like pattern that changes over time. However, the intensity of the effect is quite pronounced. To refine it, we can adjust the parameters we have defined until we achieve the desired outcome. Our next shader is going to be another distortion effect, the ripple shader. A ripple shader is a visual effect used to simulate the rippling motion typically seen on liquid surfaces like water.
Okay, so GPT has given us the formula. So let's create a new material. Now I'm going to implement the formula provided by GPT, which is another manipulation of the texture coordinates. So we now have a nice rippling effect. So let's create a new material instance and see how it looks in the editor. Okay, it looks nice, but the effect is too intense and our main scene is barely visible. But I have a lot of parameters to tweak from. So you can see the extensive range of variations achievable through simply adjusting the parameters of a single shader. With Blendables, the possibilities extend far beyond just creating any filter or distortion effect you can imagine. The real magic lies in the parameters. This level of control ensures that each effect can be fine-tuned to fit perfectly within your scene.
And this is just the beginning. Our journey with shaders is about to get so much more exciting. In our next video, we will be creating a few more advanced shaders and we will also introduce ourselves with HLSL that unlocks the ability to write custom shader scripts right within the Unreal Editor. The shaders we are building in this tutorial series, among others, are also available on my Patreon page, so consider supporting me by becoming a member and in return, you will gain access to all these project files. The link is given in the description below. And finally, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to my channel for more such tutorials like this one. I will see you in the next video.